गुड मॉर्निंग डियर स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट पॉपलीटियल फोसा। पॉपलीटियल फोसा इज ए डायमंड शेप्ड स्पेस बिहाइंड द नी एंड इट बिकम्स क्लियर एज अ डिप्रेशन इन फ्लेक्स्ड नी। ओके, so when you flex your knee, so popliteal fossa becomes more clear. Okay, that everybody can see the popliteal fossa behind the knee. So what is popliteal fossa? It is a diamond shaped space behind the knee and it becomes apparent as a depression in flexed knee. So we shall see the boundaries, the contents and applied anatomy of the popliteal fossa. Let us discuss the boundaries of the popliteal fossa. Above and medially, the popliteal fossa is bounded by semitendinosus and semimembranosus. Okay, then above and laterally, the popliteal fossa bounded by tendon of biceps femoris. Below and medially, the popliteal fossa is bounded by medial head of the gastrocnemius. Then below and laterally, the popliteal fossa bounded by the lateral head of gastrocnemius with the plantaris muscle. Okay, so we shall see the diagram in next slide. So in this diagram you can make out the boundaries of the popliteal fossa. Above and medially, the semitendinosus and semimembranosus. Okay, then above and laterally, tendon of the biceps femoris. We can see the tendon of long head of the biceps femoris. Below and medially, the medial head of the gastrocnemius. Below and laterally, the lateral head of the gastrocnemius and the plantaris muscle. Okay, so these are the boundaries of the popliteal fossa. The floor of the popliteal fossa, it is formed by, number one, the popliteal surface of the femur, then the oblique popliteal ligament, then posterior part of the upper end of the tibia bone. Okay, then fascia covering the popliteus muscle. So these are the structures which are forming the floor of the popliteal fossa. I repeat again, the popliteal surface of the femur, then the oblique popliteal ligament, then posterior part of the upper end of the tibia, then fascia covering this popliteal muscle. Now opposite the oblique popliteal ligament, the floor, it is pierced by middle genicular vessels. You can see here, opposite the oblique popliteal ligament, the floor of the popliteal fossa, it is pierced by middle genicular vessels and nerves. And also, the genicular branch of the obturator nerve. Okay. So this is about the floor of the popliteal fossa. Let us discuss about the roof of the popliteal fossa. See, the roof, it is formed by the skin. After reflecting the skin, you will come across the superficial fascia, then the popliteal fascia, which is pierced by the small saphenous vein or the short saphenous vein. We can see here, this is the short saphenous vein piercing the popliteal fascia and posterior femoral cutaneous nerve. Okay, the posterior femoral cutaneous nerve also piercing the popliteal fascia. So these are the structures you see in the roof. And the superficial fascia contains, number one, the short saphenous vein, the posterior cutaneous nerve of thigh, then the posterior division of medial cutaneous nerve of thigh, then the sural communicating nerve. Okay, so these are the structures in the roof of the popliteal fossa. So we can see in this diagram the structures in the roof of the popliteal fossa, the posterior cutaneous nerve of thigh, then posterior division of medial cutaneous nerve of thigh, then the lateral cutaneous nerve of it is on the lateral side of the calf, then the peroneal communicating nerve and branches from the posterior cutaneous nerve of thigh. So these are the structures in the roof, and we can also make out the small saphenous vein or the short saphenous vein. Coming to the contents of the popliteal fossa, contents we can see here the popliteal vessels, the popliteal artery and vein. So artery is in red color, vein is in blue color. So in the exam also you should use multiple colors for multiple structures, okay? Like artery red color, vein blue color, the nerve yellow color, the fascia in green color, muscle in brown color, okay? So you have to use different colors for different structures. So popliteal artery and vein, we can see here popliteal artery and popliteal vein. Then the common peroneal nerve, which is dividing into the sciatic nerve, which is dividing into common peroneal and the tibial nerve. So the common peroneal nerve in the popliteal fossa, tibial nerve in the popliteal fossa, termination of the small saphenous vein, and posterior femoral cutaneous nerve, then genicular branch of posterior division of the obturator nerve, the popliteal lymph nodes, and popliteal pad of fat. So these are the contents of the popliteal fossa. Now these contents are exposed when the boundaries of the fossa are separated. Okay, so when you separate the two heads of the gastrocnemius muscle, you can see all these contents in the popliteal fossa. So popliteal vessels, tibial nerve, common peroneal nerve, popliteal lymph nodes and pad of fat, the termination of short saphenous vein, genicular branch of posterior division of obturator nerve, posterior cutaneous nerve of thigh before it becomes cutaneous, then sural communicating nerve. So these are the contents in the popliteal fossa, very very important, you have to memorize these contents. Let us discuss detail about the contents of the popliteal fossa. Number one, we have the popliteal artery, which is the principal content of the popliteal fossa. So it extends from the adductor hiatus. We can see here, this is adductor hiatus, is nothing but opening. This is adductor magnus muscle. So we have a opening in the adductor magnus muscle, which is known as adductor hiatus. So popliteal artery extends from adductor hiatus to lower border of the popliteus muscle. Okay, so it extends, I can say that it extends obliquely as a continuation of the femoral artery. Popliteal artery is a continuation of the femoral artery. So from fifth osteoaponeurotic opening of the adductor magnus, it extends up to the lower border of the popliteus muscle. So where it divides into anterior and posterior tibial arteries, passes down on the lateral along the floor and divides into anterior and posterior tibial arteries. So this artery is about 20 centimeter long. Okay, so it passes downwards laterally and it is in close contact with the floor of the popliteal fossa, that you should remember. So students, let us discuss about the branches of the popliteal artery. This is quite a lengthy slide. So we have cutaneous branches which supply the skin of the back of the leg. Okay, then we have the muscular branches, they supply adjacent muscles branch to the gastrocnemius. Okay, so that is the about the muscular branches, that they supply the adjacent muscles, branches from the popliteal artery. Okay, then we have also the articular branches, they supply the knee joint by 5 genicular arteries. Okay, 5 genicular arteries, and they form an anastomosis which is known as genicular anastomosis around the knee joint. Okay, this is very very important. So genicular anastomosis in detail, we have number one, the superior medial genicular artery. Can you see this one? The superior medial genicular artery. So this artery, it runs deep to the tendon of the adductor magnus, and it anastomoses with the descending genicular branch of the femoral artery. Okay, descending genicular branch of the femoral artery. So number one, the superior medial genicular artery. This artery passes deep to the tendon of adductor magnus, and it anastomoses with the descending genicular branch of femoral artery. Okay, that you should remember. Then next we have superior lateral genicular artery. This is superior lateral genicular artery. Here we have superior medial genicular artery. The superior medial genicular artery anastomoses with the descending branch of descending genicular branch of femoral artery, whereas the superior lateral genicular artery, it passes across the lateral head of gastrocnemius, then it anastomoses with the descending branch of lateral circumflex femoral artery. Descending branch of lateral circumflex femoral artery, and also with the inferior lateral genicular artery. So do not get confused. Number one, we have superior medial. The superior medial genicular artery anastomoses with the descending genicular branch of the femoral artery. That is over. Now number two, we have superior lateral genicular artery. It anastomoses with the descending branch of lateral circumflex femoral artery. Okay, and with the inferior lateral genicular artery. So both the superior genicular arteries, that means the superior medial genicular artery and superior lateral genicular arteries, the anastomose transversely across the lower end of the femur. That you should remember, this transverse anastomosis we can see. So this is actually anastomosis between the two superior genicular arteries. Then we have, coming to the inferior genicular arteries, the inferior medial genicular artery. The inferior medial genicular artery, it anastomoses with the superior medial genicular and saphenous branch of descending genicular arteries. Okay, so inferior medial genicular artery anastomoses with superior medial genicular artery and also a saphenous branch of the descending genicular arteries. So this is about the inferior medial genicular artery. So mainly it anastomoses with superior medial genicular artery. Okay, then coming to the inferior lateral genicular artery, it anastomoses with superior lateral genicular artery. Okay, and also with the anterior and posterior tibial recurrent branches of anterior tibial artery. Okay, so this is about the inferior branches. So inferior medial genicular artery mainly anastomosis with the superior medial genicular artery, whereas inferior lateral genicular artery anastomosis with the superior lateral genicular artery, and also it anastomosis with the anterior and posterior recurrent branches of anterior tibial artery. So both the inferior genicular arteries, they anastomose with each other transversely, like the superior genicular arteries, they also anastomose transversely deep to the ligamentum patellae. Now, why there is a genicular anastomosis? What is the function of genicular anastomosis? During extreme flexion of the knee joint, when you flex your knee extremely, the popliteal artery undergoes compression. So with sluggish blood flow, okay, so when you extremely flex your knee, the popliteal artery undergoes in compression, so there will be a sluggish blood flow. So to compensate for such narrowing, this is alternate blood flow is maintained by collateral anastomosis around the knee joint. So that is why we have this genicular anastomosis, or we can say the anastomosis around the knee joint. Let us discuss the popliteal lymph nodes. The popliteal lymph nodes, usually they are 6 in number, okay, embedded in the popliteal fat. So we have afferents, the superficial lymphatics, they accompany the short saphenous vein, okay, and the posterior lateral aspect of leg and foot, and from the knee joint, and from deep lymphatics, they accompany the tibial vessels. Okay. Then we have efferents. So from all the popliteal nodes, the efferent vessels accompany the femoral vessels and drain into the deep inguinal lymph nodes. So these efferent nodes, they accompany femoral vessels and eventually drain into deep inguinal nodes. Okay. Let us discuss about the popliteal aneurysm. Aneurysm refers to a weakening of an artery wall. So you can see here, the wall of the artery gets weakened, and which creates a bulge or distension of the artery. Okay. So that is, we say aneurysm of an artery. So now, how do you examine the popliteal pulse, which is very, very important clinically? The examination of popliteal pulse is clinically important in case of obstructive diseases of the popliteal artery. So normally the pulsations of the popliteal artery can be felt on deep palpation in the popliteal fossa. So when you deeply palpate in the popliteal fossa, you will notice the pulsations of the popliteal artery when the leg is slightly flexed. So if there is an obstruction in the popliteal artery due to atherosclerosis, or there is no blood flow through the popliteal artery, so one cannot feel pulsation of the popliteal artery. That is known as loss of the popliteal pulse. Okay. Then next condition, we have the popliteal aneurysm. So in case of aneurysm of the popliteal artery, the surgeons do not ligate popliteal artery immediately above the aneurysm. Rather, they ligate the femoral artery in the adductor canal. So you might have studied in the adductor canal, okay, that is Hunter's canal. So the John Hunter had described the exposure and ligation of the femoral artery in the adductor canal, right? So why? The reason is because the artery at this site is healthy and will not tear when tight. So that you should remember. Regarding the aneurysm, I told you that it refers to weakening of the arterial wall and it creates a bulge. Okay, so in severe stages of the aneurysm, you can see the rupture of blood vessel and which leads to internal bleeding, which is life threatening.